I would like to have our chaplain say a few words before we get started. Chap?
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this occasion. Lord, we've just come out of our law enforcement Memorial Week where we honor all of our officers and deputies that died in the line of duty. And we just are particularly mindful of Sheriff Carlton, who was our first officer in the sheriff's office that died in the line of duty. And Lord, we can only imagine the impact this has had on his family, but we thank you for the years that you gave him to our community. We thank you for his commitment to duty and for the ultimate sacrifice he made to not only serve, but to protect this community. And now we ask a special blessing upon his family and friends and our law enforcement family that has gathered together today to recognize truly one of the heroes in our community, Sheriff Dan Carlton. And we pray this prayer in your precious name. Amen.
Amen. Well, you know, history is fascinating. The history of our nation, our state, our county, and our city is fascinating. And today, after 100 years, I hope to bring the pieces together of this historical event involving Sheriff Dan Carlton. I want to thank the St. Lucie County Historical Society, which helped on this endeavor, and especially Rick Modine, who you didn't introduce yourself, but he's a great nephew who helped put the facts together for today's presentation. Daniel Carlton was born February 6, 1872, near present-day Arcadia. With his parents, Reuben Carlton and Elizabeth Cruz Carlton, he later moved to the 10 Mile Creek area and then to Fort Pierce. On April 30, 1904, he married Teresa Molly Hilliard. Daniel Carlton was a cattleman and a citrus grower, and in 1907 began serving as the first elected sheriff of St. Lucie County until his death on May 22, 1915, exactly 100 years ago today. One of the great stories of Sheriff Carlton was how he was tasked by the St. Lucie County commissioners, fearing an Indian uprising, to recover the bones of Indian Chief Tommy Tiger. His bones had been carried away by an out-of-town carnival owner. Sheriff Carlton successfully returned those bones to an Indian settlement west of town. The Indians were very pleased and described Sheriff Carlton as one of the Seminole Indians' best friends. Subsequently, Indians became frequent visitors to the downtown area and outlying homes in Fort Pierce in their colorful Seminole clothing. During this time, Fort Pierce was a growing town. Peter Cobb was constructing his new building downtown, the railroad was adding spurs to its section yards, and land sales were brisk. Saturday night was a lively night in town. Farmers came to town to make their weekly purchases and let off steam, and townspeople turned out to socialize. The town had no police force, and merchants had recently hired a new arrival from Georgia, DJ Disney, as the night marshal to patrol stores and keep peace. Law enforcement was the sole responsibility of the sheriff at the time and his four deputies. Fort Pierce and St. Lucie County were usually peaceful. However, on the night of May 22, 1915, that peace of the evening was shattered by gunfire. Witnesses report that around 7 p.m., words were exchanged between Sheriff Carlton and Mr. Disney, and then shots were fired in an alleyway. This alleyway right here. Some witnesses said the sheriff was walking away from Mr. Disney, and others said they were facing each other as the shots were fired. Once the shots stopped, Sheriff Carlton, pierced by four bullets, lay dying on a wooden sidewalk, and Mr. Disney was staggering right here in the street. Sheriff Carlton was carried upstairs over the St. Lucie County Drug Store to Dr. Clark's office, where he later died on the examination table. The sheriff had been shot four times in the right eye, the chest, and through both arms. Sheriff Carlton was buried in the Carlton Family Cemetery at 10 Mile Creek. Sheriff Carlton left behind his wife Teresa, his son Daniel, and his daughter Louise. Disney was carried to Dr. Van Landingham's office, which was above the St. Lucie Bank. There he was treated and later transferred to a Miami hospital where he recovered and was later charged, tried, convicted, and sentenced to 5 years in prison for Sheriff Carlton's death. Ironically, he only served 2.5 years and was granted a pardon from then Governor Sidney Katz. And this is another story for another day. What was the reason two lawmen would shoot it out in this alley behind me? Conflicting reports say it could have been the result of a feud over illegal liquor sales. Since St. Lucie County was a dry county, some say the sheriff was not enforcing the law. Others say he was. Others report that there was a fight between a deputy and DJ Disney at a local restaurant and that Mr. Disney got the best of the deputy. According to this account, the sheriff was out to confront Mr. Disney. The circumstances leading up to Sheriff Carlton's death are not as important as the sheriff becoming the first member of the St. Lucie County Sheriff's Office to be killed in the line of duty. Of equal importance is the fact that he was the first elected sheriff of St. Lucie County. He was remembered as a fearless and fair man. On this 100-year anniversary of his death, I'm honored to present to you this monument behind me. I want to especially thank Hans Cross, who located this venue. This is his building and allowed us to place the monument. And also Quinn Hazley, I know she was here earlier. Is she here? She's over here, who actually prepared this monument for us and got it here yesterday, had it installed. Without Hazley Funeral Home, we would have never been able to do this. So thank you so much, Quinn. At this time, I would invite the family to come up, share any thoughts that you might have about Sheriff Carlton, and we will have family members unveil the memorial. So does anybody want to come up and say a few words? Rick? Also, there was a lady I met earlier, Bev Traub. Are you still here, Beverly? Was a dear friend of Sheriff Carlton's granddaughter, and she said as a teenager they would come to the site and point to the bullet holes in the wall that were still here in the early 50s. That building has since been torn down and this one constructed, but the bullet holes stayed in the walls for at least 40 or 50 years after the shootout. So, Rick?
Thank you, Sheriff. I think the only other thing that I could probably add to it, also I wanted to introduce Kenny Bro. He's also the great-grandson of Sheriff Dan, and my two sons, Cameron Modine and Tyler Modine, which are great-great-nephews. But besides being the first elected sheriff of St. Lucie County, he was also elected as the first city town marshal when the city of Fort Pierce was incorporated. So he got to be on both sides of the law. So he was represented fully all the way through in this city when it was growing and becoming what we wanted to call Fort Pierce. And other than that, I think the biggest mystery of the whole thing that we didn't get to put into the story was right before he died, he met his daughter, my grandmother, and his wife, and they were going to go to a silent movie that night. And before they were getting ready to go into the movie, he asked her if they had enough money and everything was fine. She said yes, and he turned around to her and he said, "There's something I want to talk to you about. It's kind of important. And we'll just go ahead and we'll talk about it after the movie." So to this day, that's one of the other mysteries to go with it, because he never got to say what it was about or what was so important, because he never saw her again after that. They ran down into the theater and told her about the shooting, and she was hysterical. And his daughter and my grandmother were also not aware of what was going on, didn't understand it, and they whisked her away. And I'm just happy that we can remember, and then being the fallen law enforcement, we went to the two memorial services, and it's great to see this community stick behind our law enforcement, because if it wasn't for the protection of you gentlemen, we don't know where we'd be these days, and I want to thank you all.
Thank you, Rick. Very nice.
We have a lot of dignitaries that showed up today for today's event. I just want to recognize the few that are here in the crowd. We have Acting Chief Frank Amandro from the Fort Pierce Police Department. We have Resident Agent in Charge Michael Bartis from the Florida Department of Law Enforcement. We have Port St. Lucie Councilwoman Linda Bartz. Fort Pierce City Manager Robert Bradshaw and his wife are here. We have Assistant PSL Chief Rich Del Tora. I saw the Clerk of Court Joe Smith here. Todd Mowry, County Commissioner, and who else showed up here? Can't see. How are you? That's it. I can't see with the shades. Congressman Murphy's office is here. We have retired Chief Brian Ruther and retired Chief Deputy Warren Offord from the Sheriff's Office that probably knows a little history about this, but was never memorialized like it is today. But at this time, I'll invite the family up to unveil the monument, whoever wants to come on up. And I just want to invite everybody. We have a small reception set up in the private room at the Second Street Bistro. You can go in there and get out of this heat and talk to some of the family members. But come on up and unveil this monument. Yeah, all of you. Two, three. That concludes the ceremony, and we're going to head over to the private room at the Second Street Bistro. Thank you, everybody, for coming.